In this video, I am going to show you how to solve particle equilibrium problem involving three-dimensional forces. So as you can see in this diagram, there is a weight W which is suspended from a ring. A cable BAC passes through the ring and the ends of the cable are fixed to the supports at B and C. The ring is also acted upon by two forces, P along the x-axis and Q along the z-axis. This weight is in equilibrium and we have to find the magnitude of the forces P and Q. Under the application of these two forces, P and Q, the ring is exactly below the origin of our coordinate system, point O. If these forces were not applied, then the ring would be in a vertical plane which would pass through the points B and C. But due to the application of these two forces, the ring is shifted a little bit towards x-axis and z-axis, and now it is right under the point O. So to solve this problem, the first step is to draw a free body diagram. And we're going to draw the free body diagram of the ring A. I have not drawn a separate diagram, but I have superimposed the forces acting on the ring A in this original diagram itself. And as you can see, there are five forces which are exerted on this ring. One is the weight, which is pulling the ring down. These are the two external forces. This is a single cable, so the tension will remain the same throughout the length. So in both these sections of the cable, the tension would be, let's say, T. So the ring at A is subjected to two forces due to the tension in the cable, one along AC and one along AB, and it will be directed away from A. So these are the five forces which are acting at point A, and you can see that they are concurrent forces. So the equilibrium condition will be sigma F equal to zero. In other words, the sum of all the forces acting on A should be zero. So let's list down all the five forces. W is along the negative y-axis, and therefore it is minus 376J. The force P is parallel to x-axis, therefore it is P, which is the magnitude, times I. Similarly, Q is QK, because it is parallel to the z-axis. We do not know the direction of TAB, and TAC. So our first task should be to write these two forces in vector form. And in order to do so, we shall have to first determine the unit vector along AB and along AC. So let's first determine the unit vector along AB, and that will be equal to the position vector AB upon the magnitude of AB. Now, in order to determine the position vector, we travel from A to B, and check out the increase or decrease in the X and Y and Z coordinates. We move 400 mm along positive y-axis. We go 130 mm in minus x direction. And then we go to point B along the positive z direction. So we'll have minus 130i plus 400j plus 160k. And this is the magnitude of this position vector. The denominator will simplify to 450. And therefore, this result is the unit vector, right? And therefore, the force TAB would be the magnitude of TAB times the unit vector along AB. And the magnitude of TAB, we have assumed it to be T. So T multiplied by this quantity here. So this is the force in vector form. We'll leave it as it is and move over to determining the force TAC To determine the force TAC, we have to again find out the unit vector along AC, and that will be equal to the position vector AC divided by its magnitude. And to find the position vector AC, we move 400 mm along positive y-axis, we move 240 mm along minus z-axis, and 150 mm along minus x-axis. So our position vector will be minus 150i plus 400j minus 240k. The denominator again is the magnitude of this position vector, and the denominator will simplify to 490, and therefore this is the unit vector along AC. And therefore the force TAC would be equal to the magnitude of this force TAC, which is T, times the unit vector. So this is the force in vector form which acts at point A along AC, right? So now we have all the five forces in vector form, and what we are going to do next is to sum all these forces vectorially and equate it to zero, because the equilibrium condition says that the net force should be zero. So as I said, for equilibrium of the ring, the sum of all the forces should be equal to zero. This is a vector equation, and this will be equivalent to sigma fx equal to zero. That is, the sum of the x components of all the forces should also be equal to zero. Sigma fy equal to zero, which means the sum of y components of all the forces should be zero. And because we are dealing with three-dimensional forces, we have one more equation now, and that is sigma fz equal to zero. So these are the scalar equations, which is equivalent to this vector equation. So we first sum all these forces, and from the previous slide, we have just copied here TAB, TAC. W is minus 376J, P is PI, and force Q is QK. So all these five forces are in vector form, and they should be equal to zero for equilibrium. So our next step would be to club all the I components of this equation. So in this term, the I component is T times minus 130 upon 450. Similarly here, the I component from this term is minus T multiplied by 150 divided by 490 plus P. And this will be equal to zero. This is equivalent to saying that sigma fx equal to zero. And likewise, we sum all the y components. That is, now we pick the j components from each of the terms. And here it will be T times 400 upon 450, which is here. It will be T times 400 upon 490, and we just have minus 376 as the J component. All these three terms together will be equal to zero. And now we have the third equation, which is summing all the K components from this equation. So now we have three equations and three unknowns, namely T, P, and Q. And we notice that in the second equation, there is only one unknown, T. So we'll first solve this equation. So from this equation, we get T equal to 220.5 newtons. And now we plug in this value in this equation to get the value of P, and in this equation to get the value of Q. So simplifying the first and third equation, we get P, which is the magnitude of the force P, equal to 131.2 newtons, and Q is equal to 29.6 newtons. So this is our answer. So you can see that the solution to this problem is fairly simple, and the concept is the same as what we had used in solving a 2D particle equilibrium problem. The only difference is that we have one more equation now, sigma fz equal to 0. So that concludes the solution to this problem. And I hope you will find this useful. And in case you like the video, please like and share. And please do not forget to subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so as yet. So thanks for watching and see you next time.